gentlemen, welcome to the public panel of theorizing literature, Poncy, Future, Fiction, Fact. I'm Wansa Jie, and I will be the moderator of this panel for the next 2 hours. So, what is this?
Water.
Yeah, a bottle of water, right? I see many students buying this bottle of water from the Manza. How much does it cost?
70 cents?
Yeah, 70 cents, 75 cents. Not a big deal, is it? It seems everyone can afford a single bottle of water. Will it still be so for the grandchildren of our grandchildren? Will they still be able to buy a bottle of water without the blink of the eye? In the film Poncy, we see a world devastated by the Third World War, the Water War. A world in which there's no green hill, no hazy hills, no fresh spring, but desert, desert, and nothing but desert. It is a world in which all mankind, old and young, black and white, male and female, share one common concern throughout their lives, the search for water. This fascinating yet frightening short film is directed by the Kenyan filmmaker Kahil, shot on the continent of Africa and released in 2009. It only lasts 20 minutes, and I believe you must have already watched it in advance. So let us proceed to our panel discussion. In this discussion, our four panelists will first introduce four distinct literary theories and then apply their theories to the study of Poncy. Ronan will study diaspora, Yanri will study eco-criticism, Laura will focus on post-humanism, and Samuel will introduce post-colonial criticism. Now, let us start the section. There is a kind of people. They wander through strange and hostile lands in search of a simple home. But wherever they are, home is always on the other side of the sea. Scattering their nostalgic dreams along a trail of tears, these homeless wanderers form a distinct field of literary research, diaspora. Now, please welcome Ronan to introduce theories of diaspora.
Good evening, everyone. I'm Rona, and it's a great honor for me to present to you my understanding and interpretation of diaspora in the context of Poncy. As a synonym of scattering and dispersion, diaspora is concerned with the phenomenon and experience of dwelling in displacement, and diasporas are often viewed as exemplary communities of the transnational, transcultural, and the transracial movement. Since the Wandering Jews or the forced displacement of African transatlantic slave trade, or the soaring number of immigration in nowadays globalized world, since dwelling in displacement involves both a movement across borders as well as having collective home away from home, so diaspora study is essentially characterized by a search of identity and a sense of belonging in between the home and the home away. So at first sight, one may wonder, how could Poncy be utilized as a text for diaspora study, since it appears to be irrelevant to the transcultural, transnational, and transracial movement I've mentioned earlier. But through an enlarged semantic meaning of diaspora, the Maito community in Poncy can be intriguingly illustrated as an environmentally displaced community. This means it is detached from the home in nature, and it is disconnected from the past where there is a greater ecological sustainability. And also, examining the film through the lens of diaspora also reveals how the protagonist Asha is struggling in between the new home in technology and a nostalgic yearning for a return to the home in nature. So, dwelling in displacement, collectivity, the struggle in between the home and home away, as well as a search for an ecological self, these concepts are the basic for today, my understanding and interpretation of the film, and I'm very much looking forward to other panelists' interpretation of the film from their theories. Thank you.
Thank you, Ronan, for this lively and intriguing speech. And you just mentioned the sense of displacement in diaspora. But this sense of displacement is also very common in the act of colonization, which might include both brutal bloodshed and subtle suppression. Samuel is going to introduce post-colonial criticism. Please give him a warm welcome.
Hello all together, I'm Samuel. Thank you to our host and moderator this evening, CJ, for this nice introduction. So I'm going to give you a short overview over the topic post-colonialism and the word post-colonial. So the first thoughts on post-colonialism came up in 1947 when India became independent from the British Empire. When we want to put post-colonialism in a temporal context, we can say that we begin with the American Revolution and the Haitian Revolution. But the historical context alone is insufficient when we talk about post-colonialism. So post-colonial extends beyond the historical relation of colonialism and includes other themes, times, and discourses. So the post-colonial also presents itself in decolonization, and decolonization continues past the establishment of post-colonial states. So we've got a new term here called neo-colonial or neo-colonialism, which is important when we talk about post-colonialism. And neo-colonial puts former colonized post-colonial countries in a new dependency to the former colonizer. I hope I can later give some more insight when I talk about some theoreticians of post-colonialism, such as Spivak, Franz Fanon, Homi Bhabha, and Edward Said. So much for that, to give you a short inside overview of post-colonialism. Thank you.
Thank you, Samuel. I'm sure you will find the opportunity to give us much more great insight into the great theorists of post-colonialism. And the person who has made this great film, Poomsae Kahil, she's not only a director, but she's also a mother. When she talks about her film, she also talks about her duty for her children. And we have another mother just beside us, and this mother is also equally heartbreakingly kind, though she is ages old. And this mother is our nature. What are we doing to our mother nature, and how is she affecting our daily life? Now please welcome Yan Rui to introduce eco-criticism.
Thank you, Sijie, for a beautiful introduction. And I'm Yan Rui, I'm representing eco-criticism. And now I'm going to brief you the development of eco-criticism, and there are mainly two phases of development, two waves of eco-criticism. And the first wave of eco-criticism dominated the 1990s. And in its initial period, eco-criticism is a study of the relationship between literature and the physical environment. So in this period, people began to shift their attention to the long-neglected setting, and by asking how is nature represented in the literature, or what role does the physical setting play in the development of the plot. Also, the first wave of eco-criticism tend to equate the nature with the physical environment. Another important attribute in the first wave is the ecocentric approach. In other words, the ecocentric ethics, which serve as an innate bond conjoining the individual human beings with the natural world. And now let's move to the second wave of eco-criticism. In the new millennium, the second wave takes the upper hand and it becomes more culturally inclusive by redefining the nature. Nature has its very origins in the domination of humans by humans, meaning that human beings are also included in the context of nature, especially those underprivileged, those downtrodden groups like women, blacks, and homosexuals. And also the cross-pollination with other disciplines is also an important point in this period. And the pollination is the process by which the pollen of a plant is the pollen is transferred from one part of the plant to another. So that means the mutual inference and the cooperation between eco-criticism and other theories. And so so eco-criticism is a newly emerging theory, and it is still developing at an incremental rate with many other elements being included. And I'm sure ahead of it lies a much broader research arena. And that's my introduction for eco-criticism. Yeah.
Thank you, Yanru. This is a very clear speech. And in eco-criticism, we have this tension between humanity and nature. Centuries ago, Hamlet already raised an important question about the real value of humanity. Are we really the beauty of the world, the paragon of animals, or are we simply the quintessence of dust? In post-humanism, we are no longer the supreme species dominating and interpreting the world. Rather, we are a tiny part of a big universe over which we have very little control. Now, please welcome Laura to explain to us the theories of post-humanism.
Thank you, CJ. Good evening. Yes. As you already said, I represent the theory of post-humanism, which focuses on the human as interacting with the nature and technology. And there's also a critical approach to it, which highly criticizes the binary system and the system of differentiation, which we have in traditional humanism. So post-humanism is claiming for a rethinking of the position of the human, since it is not above the nature, but it is a part of the world interacting with the nature and technology and dependent on this. And I will later apply the theory in more detail to the short movie Pumsi. Okay.
Thank you, Laura. I'm greatly looking forward to a later speech about your application to Pumsi. And now we have come to the second section of our public panel discussion. In this section, our panelists are going to apply their theories to Pumsi, and I have no doubt that they will engage in a very lively discussion with each other. So I will just start their discussion by posing a question for Yanru and Laura. It seems to me that eco-criticism and post-humanism are closely connected with each other. So could you please illustrate to us the similarities and differences between these two fields of literary research? Which of you would like to start?
Sure, I can start.
Thank you.
In general, I think post-humanism is a continuation of eco-criticism in two senses. And first of all, eco-criticism only deals with the relationship between literature and environment, while post-humanism has a broader perspective by including other social spheres. And also, eco-criticism still falls into the paradigm of binary opposition, while post-humanism addresses the less divided, more differentiated issues. I also think post-humanism makes up for some of the limitations of eco-criticism, including the implicated whiteness, the decentering of human beings, the reversal traditional gender hierarchy, and the nature and the technology, which I think Laura will elaborate better than me.
Thank you. Yeah, I agree that eco-criticism and post-humanism can be linked very easily because eco-criticism focuses on ecological issues that we already have today, like global warming or the extinction of species. And post-humanism questions the position of the human that we have in the traditional humanism that legitimates human to use the nature for their own benefits and needs. So, but as we already also see in Pumsi, we see that the human is not really above the nature, because if we use the nature and if we continue to use the nature in the way we do right now, there will be no nature in the future. And we clearly see that the human are dependent on the nature and of a healthy relation between human and nature, and that there is not a hierarchy. So posthumanism really criticizes the hierarchy ordering of the human above the nature. And yeah, this is what eco-criticism also points out in dealing with this topic in literature. And yeah, so this is why it's closely linked.
Yeah, thank you. And Yenri also says that post-humanism has gone beyond the restrictions of binary opposition. But binary opposition is also very important in post-colonialism. So Samuel, how would you like to apply post-colonial theories to analysis of Pumsi?
Well, when we talk about post-colonialism and theoreticians, for example, Franz Fanon, he says that there's an unequal binary struggle of slave and master. And if we look at the movie, I mean, we all saw it, the main character, Asha, is somehow oppressed by maybe what is technology, what can be a bit related to post-humanism. So we can maybe see that Asha lives in some kind of post-colonial world. I mean, something like a new colony. However, there's still a dependency of this group to, I just want to call maybe the technology or the whole system they live in as oppressor, maybe as a new colonizer. And yeah, we can clearly see the binary struggle there.
And would you like to apply the other theories in the field to Pumsi?
Well, if I start applying all of them, I think I haven't got any more ammunition. For example, Edward Said, who wrote the book Orientalism, which somehow started off or founded the discourse of post-colonialism in the 70s, I think. He also speaks of the civilized West as the good and the East as the evil or barbarians as the other. I think this is can even be seen in connection to what Franz Fanon of in the 50s, I think he was a pioneer, said of the binary unequal binary struggle between master and slave.
Yeah, I see. And if we go beyond this binary opposition, think about the traumatizing movement of human beings in this act of not only colonization but also migration, thus leads us to diaspora again. Ronan, you have already applied your theories to Pumsi during our first introduction. Do you have anything to add to your last speech?
Anything to add? I mean, I'd like to pick up what Samuel and Lauren and Yari have mentioned about the dualism, the value dualism, because hyper separation of values is also one of the central critics in diaspora studies, because we see that when we are talking about a diaspora community, we see that even though they have migrated from one place to another, but they can't just simply leaving behind what has happened in the past. They can't just simply leaving behind what he or she has experienced in the previous location. So in diaspora study, we see this entanglement between the past and the present, and it is exactly because this intertwinement of past and present that results in the individual's sense of in-betweenness, the sense of uncertainty, and a sense of bewilderment as to how to direct her sense of self in the future, where to move forward, how to move forward. So from the intertwinement of past and present, we see future is also embedded into this web of the time space. But according to our knowledge of the value dualism, past, present, and future are seen as separated from one another. So we see that diaspora study severely challenges this idea of value dualism through its entanglement of the relationship between past, present, and future. So I think this is also a very important aspect when we are analyzing Poonsi through the lens of diaspora. So, yeah.
Mm. I want to pick up on that on diaspora. I think I can see a relation because some features of post-colonialism or some effects is that when we think about post-colonial states, how they emerged, how they were established, was often an arbitrary, like the former colonized or the states, you know, the oppressor, if I want to be a bit careful with the word, but maybe we can use it here, just drew arbitrary borders. You know, you can see it on a map, there sometimes straight, there's no going around. You can see it in the east, in the Middle East, and they didn't take, or without regard to religion, family, community, splitting them apart, you know, like remapping territories, remapping people, taking them from somewhere and putting them somewhere new. I think we can see that in Poonsi. It's like kind of enjailment somehow, you know, they were taken away and put somewhere new. So I think that's interesting, you know.
And I think the work, this short film Poonsi itself functions as a critic of this value dualism, because I was very deeply impressed by a very important feature of the film, that is, there is many facts, many details about the film that is concealed from the audience. For example, the mysterious box of the soil sample, who sent it to Asha? And as well as what will happen to this enclosed shelter, the Maito community, after Asha's death? Will it continue to remain its detachment from the nature? Will it still remains its allegedly 100% self-sustainability? We don't know. So we have too many unknowns about the details about the film, because in my view, I think through the film Poonsi, we only see part of the story. In this sense, Poonsi itself is embedded into a larger narrative of the intersectional web of past, present, and future. So I think in this sense, the film itself is the critic of the value dualism.
So who sent the soil to Asha? Do you have anything to say to this from the perspective of eco criticism? The soil, the territory, the seed, the trees?
Mm-hmm. Who sent the soil? I mean, in the Poonsi, Asha has a dream about the past, present, and future of a man falling into a water, and there are trees outside, and we don't know that's past, present, or future. Oh, so it might be Asha's imagination, it might be someone outside mysteriously existing in a barren, in a extinct nature, and sends the soil to Asha and to revive the life in this desolate land. Yeah. And if I want to apply the eco-criticism to the Poonsi, so there's a major conflict in Poonsi between nature and human beings. It is also a conflict between two conflicted narrative, anthropocentrism and ecocentrism. So in Poonsi, people are forced to discard their anthropocentric practice and resort to ecocentric ones to survive. Individuals have to generate powers by themselves, but through themselves, by pulling the rolling machine and walking in the treadmills, and every single drop of water and its derivation, like urine and sweat, must be saved. So it's very ironic that the post-apocalyptic society has to capitalize on the abandoned human resources to conserve, to save the very major natural resources. Since in our current society, we are just doing the exact opposite. And however, as the plot develops, we can tell that this totalitarian society maintains its local cleanliness by global environmental devastations. Bags of garbage are ejected from the city to the landfill. So this very eco-friendly, very futuristic society is built upon the wreckage of the past, and so we can see the human beings still haven't learned their lessons.
Yeah, I see your point, but we are talking about conflicts between two parts again. Laura, you must not agree with this binary position, do you?
With which binary position, by the way?
Nature and the human being,
yeah.
And also the conflicted narratives,
yeah.
Anthropocentrism and ecocentrism.
Yeah. I think it's really interesting that you say that there's this my too community, which lives inside, self-sustaining, and keeping themselves alive with the help of technology to save and provide water. And outside we have this big bags of garbage and the dead nature. And as you said, it seems like the human didn't really learn because they're still producing so much garbage, but it's outside of their community, so it doesn't really matter to them, to the ones who live inside, because yeah, it's just garbage they don't need anymore. And as I said in the beginning, technology also plays an important role in the future and in the theory of post-humanism, because already today we have technologies and advanced technologies in our day-to-day life, and it's gonna play a more important role in the future probably, in order to provide the resources that kind of like extinct because of our treatment of the nature. And I think in Pumsi we see that technology is integrated. It also kind of controls or overlooks the community, because we also always hear this female computer voice that's explaining what's going on, what they have to do, that they have to take the dream suppressants, for example. And it also guarantees the life of the humans inside the community. So technology plays an important role. So if we go away from this binarism that you said in the beginning, human nature, we now have human nature and technology in the future, and it's all dependent on each other. So what post-humanism really doesn't want is this hierarchy system of human nature and the use of the technology only to enhance the human.
Very interesting. I'd like to pick up on the point of technology, and as you said, there's always a female voice, a technology voice talking, and it's interesting because the members of the community, they don't seem to speak. Yeah, it's only you can hear Asha's voice when she's typing something into the laptop or whatever. And it's interesting because Spivak, another theoretician of post-colonial studies, she published a work in the 80s, Can the Subaltern Speak? So I want to be a bit careful with the term of subalternity and subaltern, but maybe it's a marginalized group, yeah, maybe populations which are socially and politically, geographically outside of the of the colonizer, and she says that the only way you need to break out of this cycle, yeah, and the only way to do this is especially lies the task lies in the hand of female intellectuals. And as we know from the movie, Asha is a museum curator. I would call her highly intellectual, and she's a female, and in the end she's the one who takes the seed, yeah, and overcomes all the boundaries and decides to break free, maybe to plant the future, yeah. So we have, because since our topic is fiction, fact and future, I think this is important.
Yeah.
I'm also very deeply impressed by the representation of the monologization of human experience in the film Pumsi. As Samuel has mentioned earlier, that in the film there's no spoken dialogue occurred between community members, And if you still remember in the film, even Asha's interaction with the bathroom cleaner, with whom she has the most human contact, is entirely wordless. So this representation of the monologization of human experience in the film, I think it resonates well with the idea of being psychologically displaced in diaspora study. Because when we are talking about dwelling in displacement, it seems that people always focus on being physically displaced from one place to another, from one culture to another, or from one nation to another. But a more important aspect of being in displacement is more about being mentally and psychologically displaced. As is shown in the film, the community members in the Punsi are psychologically displaced with regard to their sense of self, their sense of identity. Mm. As it's shown in the film, the individuals are reduced to an instrumental status of commodity. They have to do the physical labors on the machine, and there's no communication, no dialogue between them. They are just like self-sufficient atoms, alienated from each other. And this kind of being mentally displaced is a result of being first physically displaced. So as a response to this kind of displacement, we see the protagonist Asha, she responds by trying to identify with something, trying to be reconnected with something, and that something is nature. As we see in the very striking scene of Asha's breaking through from the enclosed shelter to the vast desert outside, she is demonstrating her sense of self and directing her sense of self in the future of nature. So I think this is also a very good point to mention.
Yeah, I think you said maybe the loss of identity, or the loss of culture, the loss of own traditions. I think it's also very post-colonial aspect, because when you have a dominating culture, yeah, and you have a second culture with it, yeah, you're opposed to the, you get the, dominated, the colonizer opposes his culture on you, and you have a problem with your own identity, with your own culture. You lose parts, you're not allowed to execute or your own traditions, your own beliefs or whatever. And it seems that the whole atmosphere in the community in Pumsi is very sterile, yeah? We don't see any, it's very sad somehow, you don't see any, you don't see any culture, any interaction. You don't see how somebody executes, or like what we even may call living. Yeah.
And if I can say something to that, because if you think of the way they live there, they're just acting like machines, you could say, like working on the treadmills, not really talking to each other, not really showing any expression or feelings. Really, they're just like, and somehow that really seems like robots with no human feelings or characteristics. And this is, can also be seen as a branch of posthumanism, which is called transhumanism, which is like a transition between machine and the human. We have it a lot in science fiction movies, and Pumsi also is in the genre of science fiction. And yeah, where humans are being machinized, the machinization of the human. And I also wanted to add something to Asha being the main character, because she, as a black woman, is like the main character and the hero of this movie, because she is the one who breaks free and who plants the tree, who brings new life. And as a black woman, she represents the one who are like excluded or degraded in this binary system that is so highly criticized by posthumanism, this binary system of the humanism that we always have, like, binary system, good, bad, white, black, and so on. And I think that in Pumsi, Asha plays a really important role, that she is the one who breaks out and who brings the new life.
Yeah, I really like this point about Asha breaking free. And just now, Samuel mentioned Spivak's point about the female intellectual. And I really want to bring gender studies into our discussion as well. So Eco-feminism is also a very important branch in eco-criticism, and it is rather a blending of eco-criticism and gender studies. So Yanri, could you please introduce to us what eco-feminism is really about?
Yes, just as I mentioned, in the second wave of eco-criticism, and the theory became more culturally inclusive by the cooperation with other theories. So ecofeminism is a product of the mutual influence between eco-criticism and gender studies. So ecofeminism basically analyzes the relationship between the patriarchal oppression of women and the human domination of non-human nature. So here is the analogy here, the woman, man, and nature and human beings. So the ecofeminism is mainly reflected through the figure of Asha in Pomzi, who is a trailblazer of her community. She has the spirit of self-sacrifice and seeks reconciliation for her communities with nature. You see, Asha, in order to redeem human beings' sins to nature, gives her life to nurture the plants and bring life back to earth. However, Asha finally revives in a spiritual way. And you know, finally a tree grows out of Asha's body, and it could be read as Asha's reincarnation. Asha is now inseparable from nature as if she were nature's daughter. So here we can see the intimate affinity between nature and the woman. And also, just as I mentioned, a green tree grows out of Asha's body, and the desolate, the barren earth began to breathe again with all the other trees. And this really echoes to the title Pomzi, which means breath in Swahili. And also, another ecofeministic point in this film is the matriarchal or the matrilinear society. It can be seen that the females in this society take the administrative roles while males are taking up the menial jobs like pulling the rolling machine and working on the treadmills. So it can corroborate that women are entrusted with the mission to salvage a human being and bring the mankind out of the dystopian, brings human beings out of the desolate dystopia in the post-apocalypse society. Yeah.
But I have a question. You seem to argue that the mighty community is a matriarchal one, right?
Yes, it's a matriarchal
society. So your argument is primarily based on the distribution of the job, the work in the community, because the council members and the monitors appears
yes.
on the computer screen appears on the computer screen seems to be female, but I have a question: how do you know they are real women, or they are just some virtual images formed by technology, or they are just some robots with appearance of female? How do you know? And also, in the film, we can see there's also a bathroom cleaner who is a female. That is not a very high level job. So I doubt the idea that this is a matriarchal society, because I have a bold guess that the boss of this whole community might be a robot, not even a human being. So that's just my doubt about your argument. And other part is perfect and very
yeah. Yes, because we are approaching the short film from two different perspectives.
Yes.
And it's your assumption might be valid, and I totally think it holds water. But my approach, my presumption about the matriarchal society is based on the African's history, because African community has the tradition to be matriarchal, and also here the Medusa, there's a very short poems released in the same year when the short film is published. It's called The Mother Tree, and basically describes the Medusa is the mother trees of the community. So we can see there's a shared intimacy between nature and human beings. And back to my first analysis about Pomzi, the ecocentric perspectives. So it can be established that nature and the woman takes up the superior roles in the society. So I guess we are just agree to disagree. Yeah.
I think it's an interesting idea that you said that maybe technology rules or controls the whole community.
And all the men and the women are enslaved by this unknown boss of the whole community. Mm-hmm. And just my guess. Yeah.
But then maybe it's still interesting why the holograms have like female appearance or the voice is female.
Yeah.
But, yeah. We don't really know why. Mm-hmm.
I maybe got a comment now, not on the movie itself, but the setting of the movie. Again, seen from a post-colonial aspect, if we look at the movie, the setting is in Kenya, which is obviously a post-colonial country. Also, Kahyu, the producer, I read in an interview, she says that it's difficult to get funding. Yeah, money for the movie from organizations or agencies, because they always want to tell the producers what they have to make the movie about. Yeah, so it's famine, it's war, it's all the images we know of when we turn on the news from Africa. Yeah, and because they want to state or show Africa as the other. And that's again where I'm related to Edward Said, who said that the West sees the East as the other, as the strange, as them, and not as us. So I think it's not just interesting when we look at the plot of the movie, but the setting and the whole how the movie got to be, and the ideas behind it. I think we can see that in a post-colonial aspect too, and especially that Kahiu as mother says we have the it's our task to make a brighter future, to tell our children our story, the story we want to break out of the whole cycle. So maybe we can relate this a bit to what Spivak says. So I think altogether there's like a little connection between all the theories of post-colonialism and just everything about the movie, not just the plot in the movie, as a final thought.
Yeah. I think what you just said, that there's always the other, this can be linked to a post-human view as well, because this is what is criticized by the post-human theory, that it seems that everything is compared to the human, or what is understood as what is human. If you think of it in this very category of human, there are humans excluded, so not every human is above everything else. So there are some humans who have this privilege and some who haven't. And I think that's what you just said, basically, and that is what posthumanism tries to do, that to break apart these like binary ways of thinking, and to show that there is no need to compare everything, but to accept that there are differences. And it is the same with animals. Also, there are no animals in Pumzi, which you might question as well, why are there no animals anymore? And Kerry Wolf, for example, says, who is a scholar of posthumanism, that animals are different, but this is good that they are different. They don't have to be human, and we don't have to protect them because they are like human beings, or they also have feelings and so on, but
they have their own rights to exist, and those rights are not because they are similar to human, but because they are also life forms, and life forms that are necessary for the whole world to exist and to keep alive, to stay alive. Yeah. So I just want to add this to your theory.
So, in this world of Poncy, we see a future in which we can find no animals anymore. And Samuel just also mentioned that Cahill shot this movie to tell our children about the future. And thus leads us to the central topic of our panel today, future fiction fact. So I have a question for all of you. How do your theories and how does Poncy associate or interact with the central topic of our discussion?
May I start? So I think it's also for you. So when we look at the term post, I think it's not only that it defines an end of humanism or of colonialism, but it's got a strong relation to the reality or the identity in the present, and so consequently, ergo, it will have some importance, or is of great importance in the future as well. So I think this is something that will continue through, just if we look at the term of post-humanism, post-colonialism, or something like that. Yeah.
Oh yeah, I can continue. And speaking from an eco-critical perspective, I want to first introduce a quote from Le Cahill. I'm not here to tell people to conserve the environment alone. I'm showing them what will happen if we don't. So this really corresponds to our panel topic. In future fiction, the fact, if we don't cherish our present, then what fiction depicts in the future would become the fact one day. So that's how the three concepts are entangled together, and with its power and profundity still sheds light on the issue of environmental protection.
And from the perspective of diaspora, I think fiction refers to the dilution of the denied dependency between past and present, and also the delusion of maintaining total displacement and detachment from nature. And following this, I think fact refers to the undeniable sense of in-betweenness as a result of the entanglement between past and the future, past and the present. So in this sense, through the lens of diaspora, future implies how one directs one's sense of identity in the future to move forward. So that's my understanding of this topic, of the topic of this panel discussion from the perspective of diaspora.
Okay, for me, it's quite similar to some of your theories, because we have the facts nowadays, like the environmental problems, this issues among humans that are caused by this binary system, by the hierarchy that some humans are above other humans and above the nature. Those are facts, and we see in this fictional work that those facts can become real, serious facts in the future. And posthumanism, as Samuel said, the post maybe does not really talk about the end, but something beyond, or especially something different, like post in a sense of being the end of how it is now, and changing in another approach, another way of thinking. And we see in the end of Poncy, we don't know if she really dies, maybe she dies, but there's also this tree growing. And when there's a zoom out, we see other trees a bit far away. So probably this is not the end, but maybe it's just a changed world after that.
One comment to that, maybe it's also the beginning of new life. And I think it's interesting when we think about that the movie is set in Africa, that's an African community in Kenya in after the Third World War, and I don't know which year exactly. And if you think about it, where our life started as a human being was Africa, basically. So when we look at it from a from a historical point of view, so Homo africanensis, or you know, before the Homo sapiens, actually came from Africa and then populated the world. And I think it's a nice idea to think about that when you look at the end of Pumzi. Like, is it new life that comes again out of Africa? Is it life ending there then again? So yeah, it leaves a lot open for future.
And I like the idea how the mito seed connecting
mm-hmm.
both past, present, and future. That the runs throughout the whole film, because we see the mito seed is definitely something from the past,
yeah.
and it's contained in the present in the virtual natural history
yeah.
museum, and it's planted in the future. So it's really fascinating to think about how a seed, cutting throughout the whole film
mm.
and connecting all the ideas. Yeah.
Yeah, to pick up the Medusa, and Medusa in an African language means truth, because as Ronan just mentioned, the seed is being carried through from past, present, and future. Is a very It's a very valid point to corroborate that truth is eternal and will not be changed. And this truth can mean a variety of things based on our very different four theories. That's just really echoes to the topic of difference. Yeah.
And also in the film, we can see the seed function as a trigger of Asha's determination to germinate the seed in the future and to fight against the authoritarian community. So the seed, not only on one hand, it functions as the trigger of the whole plot that pushed the plot of this film to develop, and other hand, it functions as a reminder of the communal memory of the past, and also it later transformed into a source of power that enables Asha's vision of a future in nature. So and also it makes me think of the role of this virtual natural history museum.
Mm-hmm.
The role of this museum plays in this in the claustrophobic setting of this Maito community, because we see that in the first half of the film, the museum where Asha works is like there are some exhibits about there are some exhibits associated with nature, like the newspaper articles warning of the global change, and we have preserved animal remains, and also the mito seed contained in the bottle. So all of these exhibits are like representative or metaphor of the memory of the past. And in the film, there's very strong thing in the film that is the destruction of this museum. Because it is exactly after the museum is ruthlessly destroyed by the council members that Asha begins to say, oh, I'm done with it. I'll venture out. I'll see whether there's life outside. So it's really interesting to incorporate the role of the museum into our discussion about past, present, and future.
This idea of the circling of history is really interesting, the integration of the past into the future and the connection of everything. And all your opinions are very interesting, thank you very much. But we have come to the third section of our panel discussion, the Q&A section. So, dear audience, if you have any question, any comment, please feel free to raise your hand and Laura will help me invite you to speak out. Yeah.
First of all,
yeah, thank you very much. I really did learn a lot from your perspective, and that were very complementary. And I think that's what it is all about, right? Things are very complex, and then we have language which tries to divide things into things that we can grasp by our language, and this means to silence other aspects. And I think all of you have shown this, like, because we have started off from this binarism, culture versus nature, meaning superior versus inferior, that was like the basic idea based on which then all these like isms work, like racism, for white is culture superior to black as nature, female, male. You mentioned all of that. And I think we somehow got stuck in all the critical theories because we still got stuck with the binarism, you know? So we want to interrogate it, but still we are using the old language. And to listening to you, I was really inspired to see that actually we have to find theories and languages that allow us to go beyond the binarism. And that there's a lot of power and agency in that, and also to think integrative. One is part of the other. They don't exist besides each other, but within each other. And that's why what I also like is there is not past, present, future in a linear sense, but very cyclically, and one informs the other. And you were all mentioning somehow the dream Asha has. So that is my question now to you. I think the dream gives her the agency to, you know, to believe in another truth, like where the place she's living in is called truth. And that is the only truth she may know. But due to her memories, she knows there is something beyond that truth. And I want to search for it. So it's, and she is asked to take the dream suppressors. So dream detected, dream detected. So even the technology knows if she is dreaming, you know, then she will change the word. So I was wondering, what do you think? How strong can your theories be, like in terms of triggering agencies, but also how strong can literature be? Yeah, it's somehow related to the imagination, to the literature, to trigger changes. So how do you see that from your perspectives of your theories as scholars and as scholars of literature?
I think it's a very shown in the film that the dream is labeled as a tap, because according to the authoritarian community, individuals are not allowed to have free thinking to as a means of oppression. And but what we see in the film, as was in Asha's dream about tree, about nature, about water, it shows Asha's environment. It shows an environmental aspect of Asha's identity. Even way before she determined to venture out the community and germinate the seed in the vast desert outside, at the very early stage in the film, she's already exhibiting some environmental or ecological aspect of herself. So I think to connect a dream with the memory of the past and to see how Asha is connected with nature and how this in-betweenness between the closed setting and the outside vast desert is put at the opposite of this delusion of homogeneity. So I think it's really fascinating to think about how the metaphor of the dream functions as a reminder of the sense of identity, of the sense of self to be not only social, relational, but also ecological.
Mm-hmm. Okay. I don't know if I understood the question right. So is it how does literature help to trigger, to break free? Was that the question?
Yeah, exactly. So if dream...
So if you put the literature instead of the dream or compare it, I think literature is... when you look at it generally, very, very strong, very mighty, very powerful. It forms opinions, it can be revolutionary, it injects mindsets.
Mm-hmm.
So, yeah, of course, also literature is always subjective.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, and it's very strong. So I think depending what you read or how far you go, it can always help you to go beyond something or to overthrow something, to break free, not just in your mind, but maybe to motivate you to actually physically act.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I think it also depends on how you read, not only what the literature might say, but you have to be able to read beyond the lines and to go away from this binary system, because as you said, it really seems to be like so integrated in our life, in our world, that it probably is hard to like go away from it.
And the post-human ideas, when I read about it, I thought, yeah, that sounds all pretty good, and it makes sense, but it also sounds difficult to actually start to think differently, and that not only a few scholars think differently, but that many people start to think different. And I think it's also what you said, that we have to keep reminding ourselves that there are other things, and like the dream that that she's not only stuck in this mighty community, but that she remembers there are other things, and it's worth fighting for it.
Yes, it's very intriguing. There's a close relationship between the dream and literature. So we can consider dream as the text and Asha as the reader. And so someone mysteriously injects the dream into Asha's head, and Asha as a reader began to interpret it and began to analyze it, began to identify things that is identify things that bears resemblance with her. So from my perspective, so the dream is a container of the memories about the ecological past, and Asha as an ecological reader, they extract the sustainable meaning from the dream, and began to began her search for life, and began her search for truth. And that's, I think that's how the dream and the literature can be interwoven together. And also that's irrelevant to your question, but Ronan mentioned the society is the authoritarian, but I think it's even worse, it's totalitarian. And actually, that's the difference between these two terms. Authoritarianism means a society. In a society where people's behavior are being controlled, well, totalitarianism means a society in which people have thoughts and ideas are being manipulated by a governing body. So I really think the this Madhu community, in this society, their thoughts and behaviors are being controlled because they have to take the dream's presence to suppress their dreams, their unconsciousness. So it's really in an ideological level. Yeah.
Totally buy that.
May I have a follow-up question, please?
Of course.
Thank you very much for these answers, and I do love them a lot. And also, like, coming back to what you said earlier, like that Africa is here the setting of a sci-fi movie, which, if you look at the blockbusters, is usually missing. If you think all of the Armageddon and others, like the African continent sort of vanishes in the very first 10 minutes, and then it's a happy end because all people in LA do survive. So that is now a completely shift of perspective, of course, and I liked that you did point that out. But it's also interesting that this female activist, you know, the woman who dreams and therefore dares to go into a dangerous situation to make, to give the world a second chance, you know, a second birth. But it's interesting also if you look at what is actually happening. So she goes there with a seed, and she goes there because of a dream. And then she lies down and she waters the seed in a dry soil with her own body. And somehow she brought the water, the little water she has in the bottle. So I felt it's everything present. It's technology and it's the material and the immaterial world, like water and the body and the dreams, which together build a future. So that is like what I really got from like the different perspectives, and it's very obviously very helpful to read them together. And also I like this idea to take her as a reader of society and of a dream. And I think that's what I learned from you, that the way in which you read the texts from your theories opens new ideas. And if you would find like a language for rethinking beyond binarism, do you have any like concepts or ideas how you would, so are we sort of trapped or caught in the trap of that we use a language we have learned, but still in academia we have to use language to make our point. And from you, all of your readings and the readings of Pumzi, do you have any ideas how to go beyond that binarism? I don't have, so you know. It's just a, but maybe it's more than a dilemma and an aporia. Maybe
the most simple thing you can do is invent or create a language everybody can speak.
Yeah.
Esperanto, or we had like prototypes, but it didn't work. I cannot think of something else. How we would be something tele, something with tele, yeah. Telepathical, or I don't know what it's called, to communicate via thoughts or something, but that's something
yeah,
very...
Right. And that you also think in your language.
Yeah.
And language also
yeah, but
kind
you could,
of
but you could think, but you could
think
in, you could
think
in pictures.
Uh-huh.
Yeah, some languages think in pictures and some
but
don't,
don't.
So, yeah, I don't know. It's a interesting question, but I think it's, yeah, hard to answer.
Drawing.
Because,
like
but
activity.
I think that, yeah, as I said, language really influences the way we think. So if we want to think differently, then there maybe we should use another language. But if yeah, we use the language to think, so it's kind of it's like a circle.
Yeah.
That you have to break up. I don't know.
Yeah, but I think if you we were all once in a situation where you had your communication partner didn't speak your language, or you didn't speak his or her language. So what did you do? Yeah, you went back to the roots, you tried showing, you did like gestures and something like that. And it works.
Uh-huh.
A lot of effort, but it works.
Yeah. Maybe we should dare to, like Asha, to dare to irritate and use new vocabularies, like to break up this animated versus inanimated, human versus animal, or material, non-material, and there I think all of your approaches offer already ways to go beyond that, and we have to do it more consequently to find terminologies, right?
So I think language itself is subjective, so we as people, the subjective entity, inject our interpretation and meanings into language, and so it can reflect many division and many differences. So maybe we can just treat language, treat the things less divided and more differentiated. So in the films, there are men and women, there are nature and human beings. There, if we just read them as differentiated entities, not as binary oppositions, it will, maybe we can project a more partial and objective perspective on the literature. Yeah.
And I think since our use of our language and our reliance on a certain kind of culture and society is inevitable, since it is already a fact of life that we cannot like to see, we find another solution or alternatives to the current language or the current culture mode. So I think the most important thing is to always bear in mind your culture, your perspective is embedded in your own narrative. So you as long as you always remind yourself that your perspective and your language is limited, so this will allow you to embrace difference and diversity. So I think that is maybe more important than trying to find a solution or an alternative to language or...
The girl in pink who sits in the front row, before our discussion you told me that you are very interested in the meaning of the body in this movie. Are you still interested enough to pose a question?
Yes, actually I really like Professor's idea that in the movie Pumzi, nature, technology, and the human body and the human mind, as in dreams, are together building a future. And I have a question for Lara. As you see, the representation of body is very interesting and original in the movie. The human body are the human bodies are verbally silenced and they are acting like machines. They are exploiting their physical bodies to keep the community to go on. And I know post-humanism is questioning the traditional definition of human beings and the position of human beings in the universe. So my question is, how would you interpret the representation of body in Pumsi?
You mean body in general, or may I look at Asha's body, for example? Cause she.
Yeah, of course.
Because then I think that Asha, as her body, a woman body, a black woman body, she represents in this old binary system. She represents the suppressed part, suppressed side. But by breaking free and that the tree grows with the help of her body and the water. there can be seen maybe a shift of power because she, and as you said, they are just the body is just used as a machine or like a machine to just simply to stay alive and not really to live. Mm-hmm. But when she breaks out, she has there's a shift of power, a power that she has to grow new life, and I think that this. Is the understanding of that the body plays an important role in Asha because it shows that the body can only act like a machine on one side, but if you break out, it can also provide new life on the other.
Do you have more idea about the representation of other members' bodies, like the bodies of the members of the community?
Well, they're they're using their bodies from the physical perspective only, I think. Not really living, but acting and moving in order to stay alive, to make the machines and the technology work and useful for them in order to provide water for the community. And I think that's interesting, and that Asha is the one who used to be stuck in this treadmill as well, in this like just using the body to stay alive, kinda, and she breaks out, and so the rest of the community is still in this cycle, but she isn't. Yeah.
Thank you.
I may have a relevant question according to her question, because we had said that a human is being manipulated or controlled in these movies. And one assumption from you is that they are controlled by machine or robot. So I was wondering, what's the relationship between the human and the technology? Is the technology one part of the human intelligence, or technology has already isolated itself from the human body or human beings and become a third party, like apart from the human and the nature?
Yeah, I think, on the one hand, Pumsi leaves it open to your own interpretation if the technology is really ruling the community or if it is part of it. But from a more post-human perspective, I could say that it is not really the idea to find a new hierarchy where the technology is above everything else, but to really to try to level human technology in nature and to realize that they are mutually dependent. And so we have the technology and we can't really stop it from existing or improving, and so we have the technology keeping the lives alive, but it shouldn't be seen as above nature or the human. But also you can like find other interpretations, and you could say that technology is ruling the mighty community.
I can just jump in, because that's exactly how I would see it, that that there is a hierarchy and that technology is a colonizer or a former colonizer, and we've still got this dependency of the humans here being colonized by or being ruled by technology, and they somehow mix, they somehow adapt because they have to, but there's still a clear cut. That, so yeah, for me, technology in this, in the way I was just explaining, technology is over the community in that sense.
Yes, I agree with them that the technology is the overarching force up above in the air and controlling the whole community.
Mm.
As we can see, the technology cuts the communication between human beings. It silenced their interaction, and every dialogue is wordless. And also, technology severed the connection between human beings and nature by building a very enormous garrison of their enclosed shelter. So it's really the serves as the overriding power that controls the whole community and its members. Yeah,
please. I have a question. Because in this poster we can see Asha's clothes is quite uniform in the movie Ponzi. Everyone seems to wear the same clothes as a uniform. And since everyone wears the same clothes, it's kind of machinalized in the movie. So I wonder how Laura and Sam can relate your theory to this clothing in this movie.
Maybe you could say that everyone wears the same thing to show that they're the same, basically, or in the same community. But yeah, what would you want to
say? Well, yeah, exactly. I mean, if we look at the clothing of prisoners, it's the same. Yeah, not everywhere. Yeah, but when you have a look at that, so it's marks people. Yeah, in a specific way. You can have uniforms. You can have like highly decorated. You can be high army officer or something like that. But in this case, it can mean poverty. It can mean marked. Yeah, as subaltern. Yeah, as marginalized, as subordinate, maybe as oppressed. Yeah, it certainly marks in a distinct way the figures.
Can I have a comment? I think the uniform in the movie represents the conformity of the people to the community, because they are forced to follow one voice and one system of rules of living in that community.
But actually, under the surface of this conformity, as you've mentioned, is actually there are some traces or signs of individuality shown exactly on Asha's body.
Yeah,
I don't know whether you've noticed in the film that at the very beginning of the film, when Asha is awakened from the dream about nature, the makeup on her face, the eyeshadow on her face is kind of a mixture between gray and blue. But in the second half of the film, the eyeshadow, the color of the eyeshadow on her face is changed into a mixture of kind of gray and brown. So even though we may say that this person is dressed exactly the same as all the other community members, but there are some subtle signs or traces of displacement has already occurred on that body. So I think we need to dig deeper and look more in detail about the dressing and makeup of the character to see whether they are truly uniform with others or they are differentiated from others.
And also I noticed that when she breaks free from the world into nature, there is a scarf in her body, which means she reconnects with nature, because in the laboratory, in the museum, she never needs that. And then when she breaks free, there is a reunion of human and nature, so there is something attached on her body. Yeah.
Yeah, so we have individuality popping up in a totalitarian society of sameness or a dystopia. And Yanri, during our discussion, you mentioned totalitarianism and dystopia more than once. Do you have anything to add to this field of Poomsie?
The homogeneous uniform?
Yeah.
Oh, sure. Actually, the homogeneity is a very important aspect of totalitarian, and it's a way of the governing body inflicts
mm-hmm.
control over its members. It's like just what Wang Xi mentioned, they are giving a one voice, they are giving a unanimous voice in order to keep everything in order, and that's a way of the government giving control. Yeah.
Yeah, I see.
And
there's a question.
Yeah. Sorry for being late. I missed most of the work of the panel discussion, and I watched the movie Ponzi a long time ago, and not very clear about it. So I have some questions. And one is about when you mentioned that the technology might be the overarching force controlling the community. And I was thinking considering the story was happened in Africa, and then the kind of representation of technology might be a kind of form of the modernity. And so how could you explain the modernity brought by the outside and with the technology, and how it influenced the local community and then also influenced their thinking patterns and also the whole discourse in the place that was happening. And then another question is about also when you talk about the body and it was taken as the machines, and then I was thinking whether this is also related to the capitalism that was that come with modernity together to the African. And also another one is about the dream, when the girl dreamed about the plants and trees, and then she got the chance to break through and get in contact with the seed and all the thing, if I remember right.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, and then I was thinking whether the tree or the seed has its own agency, and then the dream is a kind of the way how the tree or the seed try to communicate as another way of language and communicate, express his agency and then communicate to the girl, and then they were interacting. And I know it's a little bit maybe not so practical, but just some questions.
These are very fascinating questions, and perhaps we can answer them one by one.
Yeah.
And which of our panelists would you like to answer a question about technology?
Maybe this part, because they talk about technology.
Yeah, sure.
Okay. But can you, because you said ask all your questions. And
the first one is you were saying technology was taking over the community, and then the is controlling the body and of the and also the people there. And then I was thinking from history, for they always arguing for the colonization and saying the Western came to Africa because actually they helped them because they brought technology and also development. And then that's also the era of where the modernity begins. And then so I was wondering whether that is also kind of in the movie when you are seeing technology is ruling the community, and then whether that can also be a kind of representation of the colonization or of the history.
I think you just answered your own question.
Yeah.
I think you can very much you can see technology as a metaphor for the colonizer, but you might as well just I think it's a very good input. You might as well just see that technology is the thing that rules because it's brought by the colonizer.
Yeah, I think you're right, Joe.
and with the idea that they helped because they brought technology.
But yeah, in the movie it's not like that, of course. They're enslaved by technology. Yeah, maybe that's just a metaphor for that. It wasn't good. I don't know what to.
Yeah, but they've been enslaved when the colonizers came to Africa and said, "We bring the Western world because our world is better, and you need this." Basically, I said it like roughly now, but and yeah, I think this can perfectly be linked to posthumanism as well. To think that some people have the right to say what is right, what is good for other ones, and what they need. And we see this in the movie that Asha breaks out of this. And if you say that technology is ruling and controlling, it is not a life that she wants to live, or she has the trigger, the dream that there is it is worth to escape from it and maybe to find something else.
And your next question is about
the body as a machine and of like also capitalism, but
I understand your question. You mean the control of the body is part of the modernizing forces of capitalism, right?
Mm-hmm.
And which of our panelists would you like to choose for this question? So who would like to answer this question about body, modernity and capitalism? Maybe you mean that just as what happened in the 17th, 18th century when the modernizing forces of capitalism began to control the body for the sake of economy and efficiency, in Pumsi we also have the community controlling the body to produce more energy with less forces. Do you mean this?
Yeah, but I don't like only associate this film with the past history.
Yeah.
Or with the past, because like it's not only about the past or present, but it's also about the future. So like the things is not only about the capitalism controlling the your body, but also like the things that imposed on the body, and then maybe in a movie it becomes a kind of metaphor. And yeah, also just the idea. Because I watched the movie a long time ago.
I could maybe think that in the past, the human body or the body was physically now very, very important for capitalism, and the rise for capitalism, as you just said, being exploited on many, many workforces, and that maybe in the future it will be reduced and become less because the physical work won't be that required anymore, because maybe we, and now we've got it again, technology, we put our focus on technology, and this optimizes and modifies our working process. That's maybe my idea.
Perhaps our current situation can be used as an example to demonstrate the failure of human communication, which is also a very popular topic in modernism. Perhaps we have all the isms today here.
Okay, yeah.
I have a question. Where do you draw the line between enslavement and life saving measurements that are necessary?
I think you mean the idea that the people are enslaved by the technology, but they need the technology to survive.
Mm-hmm.
Right.
Yeah. Well, and also the people were the ones who created or developed the technology.
Mm.
So yeah, the line. It's hard to draw, maybe. because as I said, it's all depending on each other. The technology wouldn't exist without the human, and human wouldn't exist without the technology. And we also have the part of the nature which can't be left out. So I don't know if it also is really necessary to draw a line.
Mm-hmm.
Because, it's more interacting. Not really, we have this line, and there's technology, and there's enslavement or help, but we have like this interacting between both. That would be my answer.
But first, after they've been enslaved, all the focus was on just working for the resources that keep you alive. So it's a kind of a contradiction, I don't know. Because first, through the enslavement, it made us or made them, or made generally people or whatever work to survive. So without the enslavement, maybe the focus wouldn't be on that.
But when you are mentioning that technology is already over ruling the community, and then maybe the technology has already obtained their own agency, and which means they have been out of the control of the humans, and then I mean you can't say maybe then like we have enslaved the machines or things, and when they got their own agency, and then.
Then they enslaved us.
Yeah, I don't know.
Yeah, may I raise another question? Irrelevant to technology. I have a question to diaspora.
Okay.
And you have mentioned in your introduction that the diaspora is about displacement, and most likely it's a physical displacement leads to psychological displacement. Is it possible that without physical trigger and you already feel that this psychological displacement, like for what I know is that the poets from Romantic period,
okay.
Yeah, they have often feel more connected with nature. Well, in another period, maybe in 18th century, the poets feel more connected to reason. It's like people do not need to be displaced into another place. They already feel a struggle between the reason and the nature, between the sense and the sensibility. So is it possible that the physical diaspora, psychological diaspora, is like eternal, or it's a common thing for every human being from over birth to over death?
Yeah, I get your point. The reason why I said before that it's like at first there is a physical displacement, then the psychological displacement is kind of a byproduct or a result of such physical displacement. The reason why I state as such is because traditionally and conventionally in diaspora studies, it is because people are first being physically displaced, and this displacement intensifies the struggle between like the human society or nature. I definitely admit that even though people like I stay in this classroom without moving to anywhere, without anybody or movement, I may feel like a nostalgic yearning for something that is not held in this, not that is not held in this classroom. I definitely admit that physical displacement and psychological displacement have to be like intertwined with each other. But what I want to highlight through mentioning first physical displacement is want to add that it is exactly because of this body displacement that the struggle between the home and home away, or a certain object or something in this space, is the struggle in between these two forces or two objects is intensified by this physical separation, but it's not like a prerequisite for a people to feel like displaced psychologically. So, and also if you say that we don't have to be like physically separated from some place or some location, that is not included in diaspora study, because if in that sense everything can be included in diaspora, that will be too inclusive for a critical approach to be called diaspora. So they're not like a total bond together, but it's just the first one will highlight and intensify the latter.
Did I answer your question?
So I assume that one premise of the diaspora is that it has to be transnational, it has to be transcultural.
I mean, it doesn't have to be transnational or transcultural, because in the film, we don't have any like transnational in a very strict sense, because in the film, there's like no other community that is contrasted with this mite community. What we have is the contrast, the opposition between nature and human. So when I was applying the theory of diaspora into the examination of this short science fiction film, I already said at the opening speech of my perspective that I was using an enlarged semantic meaning of diaspora. So it doesn't have to be like two certain nations or more certain nations or cultures have to be involved. It's like it could be environment and the humanity. So
in a larger sense, diaspora is a common subject, but when you are talking about serious diaspora, you are talking about the cultural.
Yes.
Okay.
So time flies and we have come to the conclusion of our public panel discussion. Today, dream has been a very important topic of our discussion. In post-colonialism, we have the marginalized race's dream of freedom. In eco-criticism and post-humanism, we hear the dream of human beings for a better, a more beautiful world. And in diaspora, we have the searching, yearning, and eternal dreams of the displaced. So, thank you, all of you, our panelists, Ronan, Yanri, Laura, and Samuel, for sharing with us your interesting opinions. And thank you to our audience for giving us your invaluable voice. And for those who have been voiceless today, thank you, Wang Jie, for your indispensable technical support. Thank you, Hannes and Christina, for your hard work on public relations. And thank you too, Wenxin Huiyu, for stuffing our stomach with delicious desserts. And last but not least, I would like to thank Professor Aunt Samira and of course Shireen, who unfortunately is not here today, for creating this excellent course during the semester and creating this excellent panel today. So thank you all of you for this intriguing, brilliant panel discussion.
And the wonderful
come on.